200. We're breaking.
We copy 200. Inspiration 4, on behalf of SpaceX, welcome home to planet Earth. Your mission has shown the world that space is for all of us and that everyday people can make extraordinary impacts in the world around them. Thank you for sharing your leadership, hope, generosity, and prosperity. And congratulations on your incredible journey.
Thanks so much, SpaceX. It was a heck of a ride for us. Just getting started.
Copy, just getting started.
So welcome back, Inspiration 4.
All right, heck of a ride, just getting started. That's what we just heard from one of the four in the capsule, and we just saw a successful splashdown. So to make sense of this historic moment, I want to bring in CNN's space and defense correspondent, Kristen Fisher, and we also have special guest tonight, former NASA astronaut Mike Massimino. He is the New York Times bestselling author of Spaceman and an Astronaut's Unlikely Journey to Unlock the Secrets of the Universe. Kristen, what a momentous moment. What did we just see?
Pam, you could hear the sonic boom here at Cape Canaveral as the Dragon capsule and the Inspiration 4 crew made its way through the atmosphere before splashing down just off the coast of Florida. And sorry, we've got a Disney cruise ship going behind me. This is a busy port, Cape Canaveral. But, you know, what we just witnessed was the successful completion of the first all-civilian trip to orbit. They're now safely back on Earth. And what those amateur astronauts just experienced, they just felt up to 5 G's of force pushing them down in their seats as they made their way back through the atmosphere. The capsule just experienced temperatures of about 3,500 degrees Fahrenheit. This plasma firewall engulfing the capsule, causing this communications blackout. It is normal, it is expected, but every time that happens, it causes a bit of nerves on the ground and inside the Dragon capsule because there is zero communication between the ground and the crew for those 7 minutes. But they came out of that blackout just looking beautiful. The small drogue chutes deployed, starting the slowing down of that capsule, then the main parachutes, and then as you saw, it just splashed down in the Atlantic Ocean. And so now what we're going to see are these two fast boats swooping in. They're there within 2 minutes of splashdown, and what they're there to do is provide a sort of sniff check. They make sure that there's no toxic fumes coming out of the capsule. Then someone else, a member of the recovery team, actually hops on top of the capsule to get it ready for extraction. And then about 30 minutes later, we'll see the main capsule recovery ship arrive, and it's going to pull the capsule out of the ocean. And then when it is safely on board the capsule recovery ship, only then will they open up the hatch and let those astronauts out. And it's going to be very interesting to see what SpaceX decides to do at that point in time, because when NASA astronauts got back from longer duration flights to the International Space Station, like Doug Hurley and Bob Behnken on Demo 2, they were actually taken out on a stretcher because, you know, it takes a while for your body to adjust to no longer being in microgravity. And don't forget, you're actually on a moving ship and there are waves. So, you know, they don't want anybody to trip and fall. We don't know exactly if that's what they're going to do for this crew, since they were only up in orbit for about 3 days. So that still remains to be seen. And then after that, they're going to be flown back to the Kennedy Space Center in a helicopter where their family and all the SpaceX employees are waiting for a big celebration. And then finally, that capsule, that Crew Dragon capsule, is going to be brought back right here to Port Canaveral over the next few days. Pam?
Mike, as you watch this moment, what goes through your mind?
Well, Pam, thanks for having me. I'm really happy for the crew. I'm happy for SpaceX. I'm kind of happy for the world in general, I guess. This is something that NASA has been dreaming about for decades, where they could influence and help private enterprise get to space. And we tried it with the space shuttle. It didn't quite fulfill what we wanted to do in that area of commercial space flight, but now we have it. Truly a crew that with no government astronauts on board, no professional astronauts on board, minimal training because of the automatic systems, the way that that spacecraft is built to be highly automated, such that with a minimal training, a couple months of training, a crew can get on board and fly in space, and making it open to the general public. Of course, you need to be very wealthy to afford to do this. But what we're seeing with the reusability of this spacecraft, that hopefully that price will be coming down. So this is really a great milestone, and I'm happy for everyone involved.
Right. There was one billionaire on board and three others who, you know, don't have a typical resume of what you would think of going up into space, right? A physician's assistant, a community college teacher. You know, this crew was civilian. It was a civilian crew. They spent about 6 months training. How does that compare to what NASA puts astronauts through, Mike?
Well, as far as the training that they got for working the SpaceX vehicle, it's very similar to what my friends are going through when they fly on SpaceX. It's not that much different. Maybe a little more of the automated system in this case for these folks, but it's very similar. What the NASA astronauts, what the big difference is for the NASA astronauts is that they're in space for much longer periods of time. They're trained to do spacewalk, walks, to do rendezvous. This crew orbited the planet. They did not go to the space station, so they didn't rendezvous with another spaceship like the NASA astronauts who go into space station. They didn't get the training for the robotics and all the experiments and all the other things that you do. So what's good about this model that we have is that you can cut down the training needed to fly the spaceship. For the space shuttle, it was intensive training to handle every emergency. It was flown manually. So the bulk of your training in a training flow for space flight was in actually just training the vehicle and working emergencies, being prepared for the actual vehicle. That time has been cut down drastically, and so even the NASA astronauts go through a similar flow, but they can concentrate more on the other aspects of their spaceflight.
Kristen, I want to bring you back in. As we talked about, there were no professional astronauts on board. Tell us a little bit more about the crew and the level of risk they faced with this trip.
Well, the crew's commander, 38-year-old Jared Isaacman, he is a billionaire entrepreneur. He was on the phone with SpaceX about something totally different, something totally unrelated, back in October. And as they were ending the call, he said something along the lines of, you know, hey, if you guys ever want to send an all-civilian mission to orbit, think of me, I'd be interested. And just about 2 weeks later, SpaceX said, all right, you're in. And you know, that was less than a year ago. So from last October until now, Jared Isaacman has really made this dream come true for himself and for these three other people. And he's been you know, really focused on raising money for St. Jude Children's Research Hospital, so much so that the first crewmate that he selected, he went to St. Jude's and said, hey, you can pick my first crewmate. And they selected 29-year-old Haley Arsenault. She's a pediatric cancer survivor. She's also a current physician's assistant to go on this trip. She knew nothing about space, never even thought about going into orbit. And now here she is. There's also Cyan Proctor. She's a geology professor, a painter, a poet. She applied to be an astronaut back in 2009. Didn't quite make the cut. She was devastated. Now she got to achieve her lifelong dream. And then there's Chris Sombroski, who's an engineer. He was watching the Super Bowl last year and saw a commercial for Inspiration 4. He entered a raffle. His friend got the golden ticket but couldn't go, so gave it to him. And so that's how this kind of hodgepodge crew ended up together. And, you know, by doing something like that, a raffle, an online contest. It entered into the equation a big element of risk. I mean, what if this crew didn't get along? But it turns out after about 5.5, 6 months of training, they became very close. They climbed Mount Rainier together. They did so many simulators together. And they say that they really became a family. And so, yes, anytime you're going into space, it is incredibly risky. But SpaceX felt very confident that they had a safe vehicle. This is now the fourth crewed mission that SpaceX has launched into space. And of course, this comes after this nearly decades-long desert of U.S. astronauts being launched from U.S. soil after the retirement of the space shuttle fleet. So truly, we're witnessing this new era of space travel. And really, you know, I've been down to a lot of launches. This is the very first launch that I've been to, first crewed launch, where NASA really had no role in it whatsoever because, as you said, no NASA astronauts on board, Pam.